We'll have Dana Rohrabacher here as well, and so we're going to have probably a full night. I gave William Federer 2 hours, a little over 2 hours and 15 minutes to speak, so be comfortable. There's water over here. There's lots of the restrooms are over in the through that door. So stay as long as you want, and I'm sure that they'll be available to talk afterwards for a little bit. So we'll get started. We start with a word of prayer, and Bob, would you come up and start us off?
Let us go before the Lord. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are coming up on an election that preempts just about everyone that we've had before in our lifetime, because we see that the very nature of our nation is at stake, and it is a nation based on your word and your principles, Lord. Amen. That is what is at stake. Father, we ask your blessing upon what we hear this evening. Bless the speakers. Anoint them, Lord. Keep us mindful of that which is in the values of our Constitution and in the values of our Declaration of Independence, Lord, which established this nation's principles and the Constitution enforces them. Father, we turn this time over to you. Give us attentive ears, alertness of mind, quick to comprehend, deliberate of speech. We ask your blessing upon the speakers in Jesus' name. Amen.
And if you would stand, we're going to say our national anthem. Pledge of Allegiance, I'm sorry.
This is good. This is good.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Now we have a few announcements here. Gloria, do you want to come up and make an announcement?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
We are so happy to have all of you here tonight, and we are really anticipating benefiting from Craig Huey's awesome research. He really works hard to keep us informed, and we want to vote with moral standards and to vote our values. And so keep that in mind as you read over the voter guides and as you listen to Craig, that we all are voting according to our moral standards and according to biblical standards. I just have some flyers that I want to be sure you know about on this red, white, and blue table over here. I have what I call helpful election websites, and these are awesome. Robin Nordell's website is always wonderful. Craig Huey's website is on here, and when we have judges to vote for, Craig does the homework on that. So please take one and keep it for future reference, because they're still will be available the next time we have an election. And we have voter guides. The Faith and Freedom Coalition voter guides are on the table over here. I printed out list of, the first is facts, not opinions, about Trump and Hillary. And I have a moral imperative that was written by a pastor. And for anybody who has concerns about the moral issues and voting for president, this will really be a great help. And you don't need to take them only for yourself. Take some extra ones for your pastor, or make copies, or email me and I will email you whatever you need. Another one is called, What If Hillary Gets Into the White House? What Will Happen? I have top presidential candidates' positions, Donald Trump and Hillary, positions on judicial appointments, immigration and border security, terrorism, the U.S. Constitution and the Second Amendment, and on abortion. I have 28 things Donald Trump promises to do as a president. I have a list of riveting videos, YouTube videos. I'm sure you all have heard about the Veritas videos that were made undercover and are really revealing so much of that we didn't really have proof of before. Thanks to my neighbor, I made a list of federal charges the FBI can bring against Hillary Clinton, and there are 15. This is federal charges. And so be sure to get a copy of that. And there's 20 years in prison for just one of these. Facts, not opinions, about Trump and Hillary. And what if Hillary gets into the White House? So please take all you want of those handouts. And if we run out, email me, and I'd be happy to send it to you, okay? God bless you. And if you didn't register, if you didn't sign in when you entered, and you don't get my emails, I need your email to let you know when our next meeting is. We meet monthly. And this is the Eagle Forum meeting for those of you who are new to us. So welcome, and we're happy to have you.
Thank you, Gloria. Bob, do you have some announcements?
We have a God who is a God of order, not of chaos. And I think we've experienced a lot of chaos in the last half decade or more in our nation. He passed on, well, Jethro actually helped establish the first order of government in Israel. And he spoke to Moses, thank you, in the desert. It's been a long day. We've been on a lot of parking lots tonight, today, with voter guides. And he spoke to Moses and said, you're wearing yourself and the people out. This is why I was still in the desert. He said, people are lined up in front of you all day long while you make decisions on right and wrong before them. This is not good for you and not good for them. You will not last, and you're wearing them out also. Here's how you are to do this, by God's will. And he said, select from, and for us today in America, we elect, select and elect is synonymous. For us, we are privileged to do that. He said, select the men, and today we select men and women, who are capable, fear God, trustworthy, and hate illegal gain. Or the word for illegal gain, illicit gain. That's the criteria that I think we should look for in a candidate as we search out who they are and what they stand for. I feel one of the preeminent litmus tests that you could have for this is the abortion issue, because that strikes directly at the heart of what God favors in man. There are two things that bring down his wrath on nations: idolatry and the shedding of innocent blood. And both of those are wrapped in abortion. Innocent blood, and taking that made in the image of God and sending it back and saying, I want something else. That, I feel, is paramount in America. That is the cancer of America that started 43 years ago with a national position, an unprecedented national position of the shedding of innocent blood, unrestrained. We have never had anything like that before, to my knowledge, in our history. The closest thing that we might have come to it was slavery. And it took a civil war. No, it didn't take a civil war. The civil war saved the Union. It took a 13th Amendment to do away with slavery, and we see clearly it needs an amendment to the Constitution to do away with the shedding of innocent blood in this nation. I see that as prerequisite before God can once again bless America. Amen. As you came in the door, and if you haven't received it, we have a voter guide for Orange County. If you're a resident, please help yourself to it. It has a statement printed on the back, just in this copy for those for this evening, by Franklin Graham, and it's right to the point. Franklin Graham, God cannot bless a nation that embraces the murder of innocent children. He's got the picture. You're welcome to take this in whatever quantity you wish, and inside of it you will also see a tabloid that explains the Human Life Amendment that's being proposed. It's being spearheaded and kicked off. Once the election's over, it will go in full bore forward. We ask that you join in with that and bring our country back to the position that it had at one time, with a reverence for created equal, with endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, and the very first one is life, then liberty and happiness. If you don't have life, the rest are academic. So please avail yourself to this. My wife can go around now with that. If you haven't received it on the way in, the special edition has Graham's statement on the back. Otherwise, we literally have hundreds of these available. If you'd like to take them for your church, you have one more weekend in this week and one more weekend to get them out. Please avail yourselves of them. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Speaking of that, this morning in Mariners, one of the fellows spoke. He said, in 2011, True News came out. There was a prophecy that Trump would win the 2016 election, and three of the Supreme Court justices would be found with some kind of something wrong, that they would be dismissed, and three more would be added, and they would repeal Roe versus Wade. Now, whether or not there's any truth to that, I doubt it. But anyway, that was one prophecy that was given, and I'm not one to believe in prophecies outside of Scripture, but anyway, that was an interesting concept, because I don't know how he would have known that Trump was even going to run back in 2011. Anyway, so now I would like to introduce Craig Huey and Lord, and Craig, I've told him he can speak as long as he wants, so we'll see.
Well, good evening. It's great to have you all come here, and boy, do we have a huge ballot. Can you believe that there's 17 initiatives, and some you vote yes, you're voting no, and some you're voting no, you're voting yes. And, of course, the Senate race. You're lucky here in Orange County. You don't have any judges on the ballot, but we're the only organization in the United States that evaluates judges. And so out in Riverside and San Bernardino and LA and others, they've got judges. And but we've got plenty to cover, and we're going to cover it all. And as we do so, you know, my wife and I, I'm sorry, she's not here. She's powerhouse. And she's not here, but we've been like, gave three talks today. This is the fourth. Almost every night, we're giving one, two, three different talks. Probably the craziest was we went to Calvary Chapel, Malibu. Then we went over to a church in Corona. And then we went over to Calvary Chapel, North Long Beach for the evening. Absolutely crazy. So what we're doing is teaching Christians how to vote their values and showing them how to be able to vote. Now, let's take a look here. This is a 501c3 organization. And as such, it cannot give actual recommendations. And so what I've been doing at the churches is I've been teaching people how to vote their values. And sometimes it gets a little confusing with some of these candidates. And so you can go to my website, and from the local city council and school board and county and state and national. We have all the propositions. Everything's there with our opinion. We have webinars on there where I give my opinion. We have a lot of other material. We even have a thing called Presidential Central. But this is not the opinion of the pastor of this church and not the opinion of the elders. It's my opinion, and I'm trying to be as objective as I can. Next. Now, Christian worldview, we're going to cover that. And religious freedom, the issues, and the research. And so laying the foundation is understanding how do you vote. Next. You know, being able to vote is based upon something. If you have a Christian worldview, what's the foundation of the Christian worldview? The Word of God. This gives us everything we need to know how to be able to vote and vote our values. You know, 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he's what? A new creation. When you accepted Christ as your personal Savior and you were translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of His Son, everything is new. Your relationships with your family, with neighbors, at work, in jobs, and in politics. You know, Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. Who does that renewing? The Holy Spirit. And so we need to be in prayer. We need to be knowing God's word, and we're going to be able to vote right. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus. You know what? A good work is to be able to vote and realize your vote will affect the future and will be recorded in eternity. So we have the Word of God. We have truth. We have reality. We relationship with family, career, and retirement, and politics. You can't disconnect these different issues like so many people want to. Next. And today, we're faced with secular humanism like never before. You know, can you believe our society has gone backwards so much, so fast? Most people don't. They can't believe where we are today. If I told you some of the things 5 years ago, what would be happening today, you wouldn't believe me. If I told you 10 years ago, you'd think you'd want to lock me up in an insane asylum. And that's because in our schools, that is basically what's being taught. It's because our society today is a post-Christian culture. And as Christians, we need to be salt and light and recognize what is happening. Materialism, thing-centered, that's a competing worldview. Hedonism, the idea of pleasure and sex, that's a differing worldview. Socialist, that's where God is replaced by government. The Bible, not the Bible as the basis of authority, it's bureaucrat regulations. And then we have relativism. That is so prevalent. When you're in elementary school, when you're in junior middle school, you're in high school, you're in college, it's relativism that you're taught. And with relativism, the biggest form of relativism are the nuns. Now, not the lady in black dresses. The nuns are those who say, I'm not a Catholic, I'm not a Protestant, I'm not a Buddhist, I'm not a Hindu, I'm not an atheist, and I'm not an agnostic, I'm nothing. That is the prevailing view of millennials today. The nuns are the fastest growing segment of our society. Do you know the voting block for evangelical Christians at the worst case is about 23 to 24%? At the best case, it's 25 to 26% of the entire voting population. The nuns have caught up to us in 5 years. 5 years. You know what? And it's a heartbreak, and many of you have that heartbreak, that most of those nuns come from a Christian household. 59% from a Christian household. They're the spiritually homeless. And these are competing worldviews with a Christian worldview. As Christians, as never before, we need to be salt and light in our society. And as never before, we got to be the ones who are stirring things up for truth and not sitting around having potlucks. Everything we do needs to be Christ-centered. Everything in our lives. Next. Now, we're going to talk at the very end about the first great awakening, the revival that took place before there was a United States. You know, the United States is incredible. And it was really built upon the foundation of the first great awakening, which was a revival, where people were accepting Christ all over the colonies. And from there, we had the foundation for our Constitution, the foundation for the setting up of our nation, including the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they're endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. And among these are life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. And one of the great founding fathers was Sam Adams. And he said this: let each citizen remember he is offering his vote, that he is executing one of the most solemn trusts in human society, for which he is accountable to God and man. Is that awesome? During the Second Great Awakening, at the end of this presentation, we'll talk about the Second Great Awakening, a revival that spread across America in the early 1820s, or the 1810s. One of those was President Garfield, a product of the Second Great Awakening. What was President Garfield's occupation or job before he was President of the United States? Remember that in school? What was he? Pastor Garfield. He looked around and said, enough is enough. Our country is sliding backwards. We need to turn this country around. And he ran for president. So Pastor Garfield, he said this: now more than ever before, the people are responsible for the character of their Congress. If that body be ignorant, reckless, and corrupt, it's because the people tolerate ignorance, recklessness, and corruption. Does that make sense? Does that sound right? Next. George Barna is a great researcher. And I'll tell you about a meeting I had back in New York with Barna and Franklin Graham and Greg Laurie. And Hillary was invited. She wouldn't see us, but with Donald Trump. And George Barna, he said, most Christian votes were influenced more by their economic self-interest than their spiritual values. Is that a sad reflection on the body of Christ?
Yes.
Next. So how many of you have been to an election forum before? So you guys kind of know what I'm going to do. I would like everyone in this place to stand up if you physically can. Stand up for just a minute. Now, I want you to look around and see all the people here. Now, with all the people here, recognize that this would represent the body of Christ from New York to Hawaii and Alaska, okay? This represents all the born-again Christians, all the evangelical Christians, all the ones who accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, believe in the cross and the resurrection, have asked Jesus into their heart. Now, what I'd like to do is have you sit down, and you sit down, you sit down, you sit down, you sit down, you sit down. Go ahead, you guys sit down. That row, sit down. Yeah, yeah. All you guys sit down. All you guys sit down. Yeah, all of you sit down. That row sits down too. Now look around. All these are born-again evangelical Christians in the United States who are not registered to vote. This represents in every church, Assemblies of God, any Presbyterian, Foursquare, Calvary Chapels, that many. I want all you guys to sit down in this area. And you sit down, and you sit down, and you sit down. These rows sit down. Oh, you. That's about right. All those who just sat down represent the evangelical born-again Christians in the United States who are registered to vote but did not vote in 2012. I would like all you guys to sit down. But these guys who are sitting down now, they represent the Christians who did vote. Give them a hand. Now, there are 80 million born-again evangelical Christians. Now, there's a little difference between born-again and evangelical. Let's just say there's 80 million. That's a lot. 35 to 45% are not registered to vote. What would happen here in this district, in the state of California, nationally, if we got 5 to 10% of the born-again evangelical Christians actually to vote? We would transform this area like never before. Well, 45 to 55% of the Christians who are registered to vote don't vote. What would happen if we got 5 or 10% of them actually to the poll? We would be able to have such an incredible transformation of government in our society. But the Christians, as a huge voting bloc, are not voting their values, and we should be. In 2012, 350,000 votes was the difference in the four swing states for the presidency. And there were there were 48 million Christians who did not vote. 48 million Christians did not vote. In 2000, the difference between the Republican and the Democrat was about 500,000 votes. 40 million or plus did not vote. The election that had the biggest gap was in 2008. It was 9.5 million, and 40 million Christians did not vote. We look around and we see our society going downhill. We see the politics crumbling. You know, I know that we've got really strong Trump supporters here. Maybe we got strong Hillary supporters. But I'll tell you one thing that's happened. No matter what church I'm at, no matter where I go, my wife and I, we started this off a place I had never been to called Oakhurst and Bass Lake, a couple of churches up there. And we've been all the way down to San Diego, San Bernardino, everywhere. And I ask people, are you like, what do you think about this election? And they all just kind of shake their head and say, when is it going to be over? And I can't believe what's happening. I've never seen anything like this. This is beyond. And there's a feeling of frustration. Is this representing America? When we see the WikiLeaks emails and the corruption and the pay to play and the millions of dollars, and it's just like unbelievable. And then, you know, people have to kind of cover their ears when Donald's on TV. You know, people are like so surprised when they've heard some of the things he's done in the past and these accusations. So you've got people just like, what is going on? But here's what's going on. Christians are not going out and they're not voting. Next. So how do you vote? Well, first of all, you have to prioritize what's your biggest issues. I mean, I could sit here and talk to any of you about minimum wage. And some of you may say, hey, minimum wage is important because we got to be able to have somebody who's working to at least get a certain amount. And I would say to you, well, you know what? What you're going to do is destroy jobs. What you're going to do is, for those people who are just starting out, they'll never find a job. It's going to hurt those in the minority community the most. And what's going to happen is an increase in automation. You're going to go into a restaurant and never see a person. And you can have this debate. But let me ask you this. What is more important, arguing over the minimum wage or talking about the right to life? What is more important, talking about the minimum wage or marriage between a man and woman? What's more important? Is it talking about religious liberty or the minimum wage? Because our religious liberties are under attack as never before, and I'll mention that in a minute. And what about the issue of Israel? I will bless those that bless thee. I will curse those that curse thee. You don't fool around with Israel. And here's the thing. Under the Obama administration, with the pro-Palestinian efforts, with the idea of splitting Jerusalem in two, so many different attacks of Israel, we got to be very, very nervous. Amen. And What is your key issues? And then you line it up. That's voting your values. Not, that's how I feel. That's what somebody said. As Christians, we don't vote based upon a Republican or Democrat. They both have messed things up. We don't vote based upon what the union says or what a business says. We vote based upon our values. Does that make sense? There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ. That's our basic principle. Next. And so we have today an incredible attack on religious liberty and freedom. You know, this used to be the country where people would flee to the United States to be able to worship according to the dictates of their conscience. That was one of the great things about the United States. And we have First Amendment rights to be able to protect us. But as you can see in that handout sheet, and as we go down talking about the difference between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, there's one religious liberty issue after another that Christians have lost their freedoms. And most people in the churches, I go to churches all over, you know, some are affluent areas, some are like Montebello in great poverty. It doesn't matter. The body of Christ does not know what's going on. For example, take this. The man on the right, Masterpiece Cake Shop, he would bake cakes and cookies and have clients and sell them to anybody who wanted to. Then one of his clients, who loved his cookies and cakes, said, I want you to do my gay wedding. He said, you know what, guy? I love you with the love of my Lord, but I believe that marriage is between a man and a woman. That's my personal belief. So go down to the baker down the street and have him bake your cake. Taking the court, he kept losing hundreds of thousands of dollars. He's out of business. You know what the judge said to him? Not only does he get a fine for violating the civil rights, but he has to have re-education. Now, that's like communist Cuba. That's just like something out of China. And then the lady, she sold flowers in Seattle. Great artistic ability, beautiful flowers, had all kinds of clients, would sell them to anybody. And what happens to her? Lesbian couple say they want to have a wedding. She says, hey, I love you guys, but just go down the street. I'll still sell you flowers, but I can't do this wedding because it violates my biblical beliefs. She's now going to lose her 401k, her house, and her business, and she's 78 years old. And what about this? There's a couple in New Mexico, videography, same situation. They said, use the videographer down the street to a client that just loved the stuff that they did. Went up to court, and this is what the judge said. This is the price of citizenship. Christians must compromise, if only a little, to accommodate the contrasting values of others. You see, in today's society, in this post-Christian culture, with the political climate we have today, you're being told that you need to compromise your biblical values. Are you willing to compromise your biblical values?
No.
Well, the apostles, Peter, was told once he had to compromise his biblical values. And you know what he said? He said, it's better to obey God than man. So the CEO of one of the large internet companies was fired because he believed in biblical marriage. The second evangelical Christian who taught a Bible study is being fired in Atlanta. The first one is in court right now, and he's the fire chief of Atlanta. Obama's given him just great honors. This man had Bible studies, and he printed up a little study guide on biblical marriage and on his position on life and religious liberty. And he was fired because of it. This is happening in professions all over the United States. And then schools. You know, I went to Long Beach State. Christian clubs like InterVarsity are prohibited from being on Cal State, Long Beach, and these other colleges. unless they change their moral code. And then employees, it's happening across the United States. Next. And then we have a world crisis. We have a world that's turned upside down, like you can't believe. We have Israel being attacked as never before. We have Iran ready to have a nuclear weapon. We have China that's not only expanding, but persecuting the church even more all across the world. And in the Middle East, we're having such incredible historic genocide against brothers and sisters in Christ. Every 30 minutes, one Christian is being killed in the Middle East. While we're sitting here, there'll be three or four Christians killed in the Middle East simply because they believe in Jesus Christ. And the problem is, they are not only a targeted group, but they are a group that have nowhere to go. You see, throughout the Middle East, in Jordan and other places, they have Muslim refugee camps. But a Christian can't go there. Because if they're with ISIS, the wife is going to see the husband's head cut off. The husband's going to see the wife raped and crucified. The kids taken away or killed. But it's just as bad in the camps. So they're wandering about, hiding, and they have nowhere to go. Well, President Obama, the UN, the State Department is doing nothing. Out of 12,000 Syrians who really aren't vetted, about 60 are Christians from a country that has 20 to 25% Christian population. It's discrimination against the Christians. And I'm glad to say we have someone here tonight who has been taking up the defense of Christians. You see, he's a congressman who stood up among all the congressmen and put in a bill called Save the Christians from Genocide. And it's been buried in committee by Ryan and the Republican leadership and the Democrats. And so we're asking you to sign this petition because we're going to hand over to congressmen throughout the United States and their congressional district, people who have signed a bill, the petition, to get this bill out of committee and get this thing passed. And if you guys don't mind, I would like Dana Rohrabacher, the congressman in this area, who has this bill, to come up and just give 2 or 3 minutes explanation of what it's about and why he's got this bill.
Don't worry about the arm here. That's what happens when people are twisting your arm to do this or that. So, actually, it's 25 years of really good surfing, and did all the cartilage disappeared. I had a new shoulder put in 2 weeks ago. But I'm very, very pleased with what Craig is doing tonight and what he's been doing with his life. We grew up together. We started off in the Reagan campaign way back in 1966, and we have been active politically ever since then. And one of the most important things we learn is that the freedom that we have inherited from our founding fathers and mothers belongs to the activists. Those people who do not get involved, they have no influence. The people who get to the degree they do get involved have that influence. You have tremendous influence on our government if you do everything you can. And you have some influence if you do something. You have no influence if you don't even vote. So if we're going to change, we're going to save our country, it means we got to get involved. And that's what Craig is all about. He's dedicated his life to mobilizing the Christian community, because we will have, because I am a Christian. Amen. And I was raised as a Baptist, by the way. And, of course, I married a Catholic. My father kept saying, stay away from the Catholic girls, stay away from the Catholic girls. So I ended up, but I did, we did reach a compromise. We have, as you know, with three kids, and they're at, well, anyway, they had the compromise. They were going to go to St. John the Baptist School. At least it was Baptist, I know. So but I want to thank Gloria and David Prine and Craig for all you're doing. This is the way we're going to save America. Number one, remember this, that don't be a purist in the sense expect the person that you're going to vote for to be totally pure and totally agree with you on all the issues. But just make sure that we are electing the person that it's closely, most closely resembles the issues that you believe in. That's how we'll take a step forward. The idea that that the person has to be, because certainly Donald Trump is not a perfect person, as we all know. And you can only compare that to what the alternative is. And what Craig actually asked me to talk about tonight, and I'll do very quickly if I can, and that is, if nothing else, we Christians should stand up for fellow Christians. If nothing else, we should be standing up for the rights of everyone. Everyone has a right, whether if they don't want to support a Christian element, they shouldn't have to. We should be supporting the Christian alternative. Well, what we have now in the world is Christians and Christianity is under attack as never before, and we have the slaughter of Christianity going on in the Middle East, as Craig noted. Always in the past, the United States has been the force, not always, but at least in the last 150 years, the United States has been the force that the good people of the world could count on to defeat evil as it began to take over the planet. Whether you're talking about the Nazis or the Japanese militarists in World War II, what would that world be like had we not stepped forward and defeated that force of evil? Communism, which was nothing more than an atheist dictatorship that they wanted to superimpose on the world, what if we would not have stood firm? And I was, of course, very honored to work with Ronald Reagan. We worked to get him elected the first time for governor. And then I was very honored later on, he chose me to work with him in the White House, of course. And Ronald Reagan stepped forward and we ended the Cold War by defeating communism. And we now have another, I thought that I could relax then and just go surfing for the rest of my life. My gosh, that was it. But we face another major evil force in the world. And it's not gonna just go away. And that evil force is radical Islam, and radical Islam believes in utilizing any type of force or terrorism in order to terrorize us into retreat. And what they're doing now in the Middle East is slaughtering Christians. And here's the bad news. We have gone so far, as Craig said, down the road in the wrong direction that our government doesn't even feel, and a lot of our Republicans don't even feel, that we can step up and say, we're going to save the Christians. That there's something wrong with saying that those Christians who are being targeted, that we are going to save people, and we're going to recognize that the ones we're saving are Christians because they are the ones who have been targeted. It is beyond me. Well, first of all, it's beyond me that we've got a president, that our president is bringing in thousands and hundreds of thousands of people, and a minuscule number of them are Christians at a time when literally tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of Christians are being murdered. So I submitted a piece of legislation. Now, there are some other people and Republicans. We now are control of the House who had pieces of legislation. And here's what it is, and this is why the bill that I submitted is really important. Our leadership honestly believes, and Paul Ryan and the rest of them, we can't say Christians because that's discriminatory against other people. It's like the boatload of Jews that came here, and we can't let them in, especially over and above the rules, because after all, that would be discriminating against all the other people who would want to come here during World War II. We sent boatloads of them back, and they were, of course, murdered by the Nazis. And so, anyway, there are several bills. One bill that they allowed out of committee says this. The people who are a minority religion that are being attacked by a majority religion in any part of the world will have priority to come to the United States, and that's the instructions they're giving the State Department. Now, let me tell you this. If you don't just force them to actually do the job, they will find a way not to do it. And I will tell you, by that definition, by the bill that came out, all the Sunnis in the Shiite areas will come here. They're a minority, right, in those areas. And all the Shiites in the Sunni areas will come here. And nobody will be coming here will be Christians. I can tell you that right now. So I've been arguing my case, and I just decided we have to mobilize the Christian community. And I'm so grateful that Craig has joined us. I'm asking you to join us. Your congressman is already on board. And it's H.R. 4017. It's very simple. All it says is, and tell you, if you got friends in other congressional districts, tell them they should sign on and to tell their congressman. And all it says is, in those areas of the Middle East where Christians, and by the way, we included Yazidis, which is a very small group as well, that are targeted for genocide, that those people will have priority over all others immigrating or seeking refugee status from that area. That's all we're saying. And this makes all the sense of the world to me, that when they're targeted, they should be the ones who receive your focus of your efforts. So again, America isn't going to be saved. These Christians aren't going to be saved on their own. We've got to do something. America is not going to be saved unless we do something. We can't just believe that just because we believe something, that's something that we're accomplishing for others. No, it's what we believe and how that motivates us. You know, one last thing, and that is, you know, as you know, I worked with President Reagan. President Reagan always talked about how there are so many Christians that they're praying and they're asking God to do something. It's something important. Something very valuable, something important for the future and for the safety of our country or for helping other people. And President Reagan always said, you know, these Christians are out praying. They're very sincere people. But, you know, they're praying to God to do this. And frankly, I think God is waiting for them to do something so he can help them. The fact is, God works through those who believe in him. And it won't happen on its own. There's not going to be lightning coming down from the sky in order to save these Christians. It's going to be fellow Christians from out the world. And it's fellow Christians from out the United States who are going to save this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dina. So, Dina, and one last thing. For the Christians coming in, you have set up a whole system for proper vetting to confirm that they are Christians. Vetting that's not going on right now with the Muslims coming in.
We're insane. I mean, this is totally. We are letting people come in from an area of the world without verifying that they are not people who want to do us harm. That's why we had some people, the slaughter of our brothers and sisters out in San Berdu. And by the way, this is, if I got 1 minute, let me just tell you. So we're being briefed in this very tight security room. There's about 200, 300 members of Congress on this whole San Bernardino thing. And then we had the heads of some of our top national security people there saying, well, what could we do? How could we? I don't believe that we should just cut off all people coming from that area. But I said, well, what could we do? And I got up and said, now, okay, how can we verify that they're Christian, or how can we verify that they are a Muslim that won't be aimed at killing us? I said, how about a polygraph test? And they were looking at each other. And I said, what about a lie detector tests, you know, lie detectors. And they have new lie detector systems now, like about the size of a laptop. You put your hand on it, and within 5-10 minutes, you can get some yes or no questions that will tell you whether this person is lying or not. And you say, do you believe all women should have to wear burkas? And if they say yes, or if they say no, and they're lying, well, you know you got some problems there, okay? And so anyway, I'm watching these national security people who are in charge right now of protecting us lean to their people and go, are we using polygraph tests now? Think about that. Well, so that was a few months ago. They still have not moved on this. Every single person that comes in from the Middle East, including the Christians, should have to put their hand on this lie detector and be asked 4 or 5 questions to find out. Now, that's not going to be perfect. Obviously, there's no perfect system, but at least we'll be able to get a large percentage of this done. So these are the type of nonsense I have to put up with. Thank you for letting me do your bidding in Washington.
Thank you, Congressman Dana Rohrabacher. So, in case you did not sign it, I'm going to pass this out again. And if you want to take a sheet for your family, your friends, your church, we also have the petition online. I will be on Fox next week in regards to this. Dana's been on a couple of times. And, I mean, they're dying, and we're doing nothing. All right. Incidentally, these Christians here.
What's the name of that bill, H.R. 4017?
I need to memorize this for TV. Yes, 4017.
What's the name of it?
Save the Christians from Genocide.
Thank you.
So those Christians there are Egyptian Christians. They could have denied Christ any minute, any time. They would have been saved. They knew their heads were going to come off. And with praise and thanksgiving, they stood firm, and they were beheaded. Next. And then we have a growing economic nightmare. I mean, we have a historic inflation rate, an increase in the money supply. Have you guys seen prices going up? You're going to see them going up a lot more in the coming years. Have you seen do you believe the figures that unemployment is like 4 or 5%. Private economists say it's closer to 12%, 15%. You know, it's killing the millennial generation who can't find a job or get a job based upon their college education, where this is where they start off in life in the 20s and early 30s and start moving up. They're at Starbucks. We have a situation of a deficit of $498 billion, a debt of almost $20 trillion. We have interest rate payments to China of $18 billion. Instead of going for our military, our defense, it's going to China. We have 8 years of anemic. In fact, 10 years of a 1.3% growth rate. We should be having a 5, 6, 7% growth rate. Taxes and regulation has stifled this economy. It's like we should be going 85 miles an hour. We're going 10 or 15 miles an hour. Instead of the lower income coming up to becoming middle class, instead of middle class coming up to be upper middle class, and upper middle class coming to be wealthier, instead of creation of wealth, like has been the history of America, we're going backwards. We are going backwards. And it's such a tragedy. And so many people are simply living off the government today. And it's going to get worse, and it's going to continue, unless we turn this economy around. Next. So, average pay of lost jobs has been $69,000. Average pay of new jobs, $43,200. The middle class is going down. Next. While he's changing that slide, those were stores that were closing all over the United States. So, how do you vote? Well, a number of Christians have been kind of disturbed about this election. They say, well, maybe we should not vote for president, or maybe we'll vote third party, or maybe we shouldn't vote. And I think as we look at the issues between Hillary and Donald, there's some clarity we're about ready to see. But Christians do not escape moral responsibility by doing nothing. We have a moral responsibility to do something, to stop evil and stop some of the horrific things going on today. Obadiah 1:11 says, Obadiah, this is when he rebuked the people of Edom for doing nothing when the Babylonians conquered Jerusalem. He said, on the day that you stood aloof, on that day foreigners entered his gates and cast lots for Jerusalem, you were like one of them. Not being somebody who's strategically limiting evil, you're as acting as if you are evil, according to the Word of God. Christians should vote on Christian worldview issues. Whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it's sin. And Christians should influence our society. Jeremiah 29 says, Jeremiah to the Jews in exile in Babylon, seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord in its behalf, for in its welfare you'll find welfare, your welfare. Now, there's two legitimate ways Christians vote. I have an article up on the website. You can take a look at this article. But one is the lesser of two evils is evil. And a lot of Christians believe in that. For example, some people who are pro-life say, I'm against abortion under any condition. So if you have candidate number one, and that candidate is against for abortion under any condition, then you have candidate two who says, I believe in abortion, but not partial birth abortion. You would not vote for either. And that's a legitimate position Christians take. Now, most Christians would take the position of strategically limiting evil. That's where with that candidate that says unlimited abortion, and the second candidate says, I'm against partial birth abortion, and the second and third trimester, I'm against that abortion. What that strategically limiting evil is I'm saving some babies' lives, even though it's not the best. You know, Corrie Ten Boom, remember Corrie Ten Boom? She faced that issue. You know, she was hiding Jews from the Nazis. And as she was hiding them, one day there was a knock. And it was the Nazis at her door. And if you haven't read her book and you haven't seen her movie, you should do so. So the Nazis asked her, are you hiding Jews in this house? What would you say? Well, the lesser of two evils would probably say, yes, I am. And what that would do is she would have been killed, her family killed, the Jews killed. She said no. Why? Because in her view, it was a biblical view, the value of life was the higher value. The value of life was primary. And so the moral dilemma she had is that she was able to save the Jews and her family and herself at that moment. Well, as Christians, we've got to decide between those two. Next. Now, as we go down the ballot, Christians, you know, we do a whole lot of research. But here's the thing with that research. We can't see a person's heart. Only God can. Next. Now, the first thing to remember, you probably have gotten in the mail these slate mailings. Have you gotten these? They have candidates, and they have propositions, and they tell you how to vote. I'm going to tell you about two deceitful slate mailings, but you know who puts these out? Either political organizations that want to fool you or private groups that just want to make money. Some work for Democrats, some Republicans, some for anyone. Some are so just absolutely weird. Some of them say, vote for this Republican, vote for this Democrat, vote for this, and it's just really weird. And if you look at the names or by the proposition, there's a little asterisk and it says, the candidate paid to be included. But you have to have a magnifying glass to read it. This one has a picture of Howard Jarvis on it and gives all the recommendations of who to vote for. And in fact, if you open it up, there is a letter from John Capel, the chairman of the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. So people get this, and if they're for limited government, they want to reduce taxes, they want to protect Proposition 14, they look at it, well, I'll take this to the poll. Well, if you look real close with a magnifying glass, I can't even read it to you. It basically says the article was not printed with his permission. And the propositions and the candidates are the opposite of what Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association recommends. Complete deceit. Complete deceit. The worst one was for Republicans. If you were registered a Republican, you may have gotten this. On the front was a picture of the Republican elephant, and it said official Republican voter guide. And you open it up, and there's a letter from Jim Brolte, the chairman of the California Republican Party, asking for a donation. And he gave the Sacramento address of the Republican Party. And then, this was last 2 years ago for the governor's race, it had the name of the Republican candidate for governor. Then all the other candidates running were Democrats. And all the propositions were progressive left. And Republicans got this thing. This is the official Republican guide. They took it into the poll and went straight down, voting against their values. Deceitful. So you can't follow those. And incidentally, you'll get them in the email and on Facebook as well. Next. Now, we look at all these conservative Christian groups, liberal groups, small government groups, big government groups. We see how they rate and how they look at the candidates. Plus, we do our own primary research. Next. So let's talk about the presidential candidates. In the past, when I've done election forums, I've talked and spent some time to talk about the candidate's experience and character and management leadership ability and crisis management ability and all these great things. I can't do it this election. I mean, I just cannot talk about Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton with some of these issues of character and integrity like I would normally do. But what I can do is talk about policy. Where do they stand on the issues? And as people who want to vote your values, you've got to look at where they stand on the issues. So we're going to look at that. Now, here's the thing. Trump has 41% trust of the American population. That means 60% don't trust him. Hillary Clinton has 31% trust. That means 70% don't trust her. Never seen anything like this. Next. Hillary Clinton, what is her religious views? She grew up in a liberal, social gospel Methodist church. Not an evangelical Methodist church, a social gospel one. She, kind of like Donald Trump, found themselves. She would go to church on Easter and Christmas, and if she was invited to speak. And she has the support of liberal Protestants, black evangelical churches, and liberal Catholics. And we'll look at her policies on these issues shortly. Tim Kaine is interesting. He's a Catholic, and he is well respected among the senators. He actually goes to some prayer meetings, and he likes to tell people, "I'm a Catholic and I've been a missionary." You probably heard that he was a missionary. You know how he was a missionary? He stayed to be a Jesuit priest, and he went to Central America, and there in Central America, he learned and followed liberation theology, which is Marxist theology, to overthrow the Central American governments. He came back to the U.S., ran for mayor of Richmond, then ran for governor of Virginia, and then ran for senator. Now, the media tells you he's a moderate Democrat, but he has, from the American Conservative Union, a rating of zero. That is lower than Joe Biden, Al Gore, or even the Hubert Humphrey. Now, compare that to Mike Pence, who has an ACU, American Conservative Union rating, of 98%. So he's very liberal. Now, he's got in trouble with his parish and a lot of people in the Catholic Church because he wants the Catholic Church to change its position on gay marriage. He wants them to change their position on abortion. And he voted as a senator against protecting those Christian business owners. Not only that, when he was governor of Virginia, you know how you'll have in city council, somebody coming up and praying, or school board, somebody coming up and praying. He passed a bill that said anybody that comes up in a public place to pray cannot pray by concluding with, in the name of Jesus. Now, Donald Trump's a Presbyterian. He's famously known for saying that he's got thousands of Bibles because people leave them in his hotels, and he's never thrown one away. He did have 84% of the evangelical support. It's dropped down to 76 after the video came out and the accusation of women. He has most evangelical leaders, and he has conservative Catholics. Interesting, a lot of people talk about, well, is he born again? Did he accept Christ recently? Paula White says that's the case. He has a lot of Christians around him. Jensen Franklin, the pastor out here in Orange County and in Georgia, is part of the leadership. And he says he did accept Christ as his personal Savior. And so does James Dobson. Only God knows. But he's surrounded by a lot of evangelical Christians because he has a faith council that he consults with, and they're always around him. But so is Mike Pence. Mike Pence is an evangelical, born-again Christian. In Congress, I've known him. He would lead Bible studies in the House and prayer meetings. And he's famous for one major thing that he says wherever he goes. And I would not, if I was a political advisor, I would have told him, don't say this. When he got up and accepted the Republican nomination, he said his famous statement, I'm a Christian, a conservative, and a Republican, and in that order. When he was being interviewed by Trump, I would not have advised him to do this. Trump was interviewing a number of people for VP. And when he got up and said, I'll give you a call, let you know what I think after I interview these other people, Pence goes, Mr. Trump, can we pray? And they prayed. And he's been praying with them every time he's with them. And interestingly, I would not advise him to do what he's doing on the campaign stump speech. Because when I listen to his speeches, you know what he's doing to secular crowds? He's ending his talk with calling people to prayer and repentance, and he quotes 2 Chronicles 7. At all of his speeches I've heard. Next. Now, Hillary Clinton has $631 million raised. Donald Trump has $279. He's put in $50 million of his own money. He says he's going to put in another $50 million. Gary Johnson's a Libertarian candidate. He has $14.6 million. Gary Johnson, he's the first Libertarian candidate for president who has not been pro-life. He's the first presidential candidate who has not respected. You know, many libertarians say, hey, the government should not issue marriage licenses. That should be the church and it should be something private. But he is anti-marriage. He is also hostile to Israel, and he wants to put in jail the Christian baker, florist, and the Christian business owner. That's not a libertarian position. Jill Stein is the Green Party. She has $3.2 million. She's anti-Israel, pro-abortion, pro-gay marriage, and she wants to lock up the Christian business person. Next. Now, why do so many evangelical leaders support Donald Trump? There's one reason why, and that is the United States Supreme Court. The United States Supreme Court is something really, really interesting because, you see, The court in recent years has been going back and forth between conservative positions and liberal positions. Sometimes one way, sometimes another. It came out with some great rulings and some horrendous rulings. A conservative judge has died, and there is a vacancy. And whoever president of the United States is going to appoint this new judge, and if it's a liberal, what we call judicial activist, the court will transform America like you can't believe. You think we've changed lately? You can't believe it. Plus, there will be two, maybe three other judges that the new president will appoint because they will either die or retire. And one last thing about this. There's the idea of judicial activist. That is a liberal judge that legislates from the bench. That's not what the Constitution's about. You see, the House and the Senate, they deliberate, they legislate. People in the state houses, the people vote. But a liberal judicial activist thinks, I, as an unelected judge, can make law because I think it's right. So instead of people voting on gay marriage, the judges, unelected, just said that's the way it is. That's legislating from the bench. With Roe versus Wade, that's what they did. They legislated something unscientific from the bench. With slavery, they said that was legal, legislating from the bench. A strict constructionist is a conservative judge. And here's the thing. Hillary Clinton has said she has a litmus test. The judge has to be a judicial activist. The judge has to be pro-abortion, has to be pro-same-sex marriage, has to oppose religious freedom laws, and oppose, basically be against gun rights, Second Amendment rights, and pretty much anti-business. A strict constructionist is what Donald Trump says. He wants his judges to be pro-life. Now, a lot of people didn't trust, you know, he flip-flops here and there, and do I trust what he says? So he came up with a list of 20 judges he promises to choose from. All are conservative, strict constructionist judges that are pro-life, pro-marriage, pro-religious freedom. And Franklin Graham said it this way, the two candidates have very different visions for the future of America. The most important issue of this election is the Supreme Court. That impacts everything. There's no question. Trump and Clinton scandals might be news for the moment, but who they appoint to the Supreme Court will remake the fabric of our society for our children and our grandchildren for generations to come. You see, when you appoint a Supreme Court judge, they're usually in their 40s or 50s. And then they're on the bench until they're 80 or 90. Unelected, just legislating. We could have America absolutely transformed for the worst or for the better for generations. That's why this is the most important election of your lifetime. Now, I'm real honored to have here Brad Dacus of the Pacific Justice Institute. He's one of the Christian civil rights attorneys that protects the Christian businessman, protects the parent or the kid at school. He stands up for the First Amendment rights. And he's right on the battleground. And his organization is a great organization. And you know what? His organization does it for free. And I'd like him to tell his view of the Supreme Court and also give you a quick briefing of some of the most important issues that you probably don't even know about that are happening right now. Brad, you take just a couple minutes?
Sure. Thank you very much. It's a joy to be here. How many heard of Pacific Justice Institute before? Raise your hands. Okay, awesome. Very good. We have a radio show on K-Wave Saturday mornings at 10:30. Awesome show. The guy, it's my show. All right. Anyway. But let me give you just a real few quick snapshots. First, there was a law in California passed that says if someone is under 18 and they're struggling with same-sex attraction or gender identity, they cannot get counseling from a licensed counselor in California. Even if that applies, if someone's a minister or pastor and they're a licensed counselor, they're banned from being given professional counseling, even from a biblical worldview. That's horrific. We challenged that. We got an injunction lasting 18 months against the state of California. It was reversed by the Ninth Circuit. And so now we're basically in a position where we're going to be filing a petition for cert to the United States Supreme Court. So the right to be able to have faith-based Christian counseling to minister is on the chopping block. Then we have pregnancy clinics, wonderful pro-life pregnancy clinics. They've been told by the state of California, every single one of them, that even though they're nonprofit, they're private, they're religious ministries, no money from the government, they're told that they have to have a large sign right there posted when women come in crises, a large sign saying where women can get a low-cost or free abortion without charge and the phone number to call. That's like the government saying, oh, yes, we'll respect your private religious freedom so long as you also say this. And that's not the United States of America. That's something else. And we think this is very important, because if they can do it to these ministries, folks, they're going to be able to find justifications, discrimination and otherwise, to do it to other ministries. And then we have Cal Baptist. They gave some of the Cal grants. Almost, we came a hair's breadth away. It's probably going to pass next year. We're fighting it. I met with the heads of Christian college universities just a few days ago, along with others, to discuss this. But the bottom line is, they came real close to passing a law that would tell all these kids who get low-income kids who get Cal grants, who want to go to a Christian college, it would say, no, you can't go to a Christian college anymore, because they have Christian biblical principles in how they hire their professors, and that's not allowed. So you have to go to a different school. Thousands of students would be impacted, much less the institution themselves, like Biola, Azusa Pacific, Vanguard, and others. And then we've got just actual oppression down here in San Diego County. This is not our first. It's real recently. A pastor was preaching. He was preaching on a street corner, preaching the gospel, which is about what? It's about sin, because you have to talk about sin if you're going to talk about forgiveness and redemption and the need for Jesus down the cross, right? Well, he's going through what the scripture says about sin, going through the gospel. Well, because one of the verses mentioned a particular sin, yeah, that's right, homosexuality, homosexual conduct, because of that, he was arrested and charged with creating a hate speech and also creating an imminent threat of violence, of inducing violence. And he was just preaching from the word. They said they would drop the charge. The DA of San Diego County, okay, not San Francisco, San Diego, would drop the charges if he would agree to go through a reorientation program. This is not the first we've seen this. So this is the kind of thing we're seeing. We represented him the day before the trial. They dropped the charges. The day before, it was actually Sunday afternoon, the trial was Monday morning. And Michael Peffer is our star lead attorney on this one. Bottom line is we see a lot of things happening. And then boys going girls' locker rooms and showers. Hey, those boys need love and compassion if they have that, truly have a gender identity dysphoria. But that doesn't mean they should be able to violate the human dignity and respect and privacy of our girls who want to be able to not have to be naked in front of a 16-year-old boy who more than likely than not is still sexually attracted to the opposite biological sex. Many people don't know that. So we're fighting that. We had a major victory just recently this summer, and I think we're going to get on the ballot in 2018. Hopefully, Lord willing, we'll be able to see it stopped in the federal courts because of Obama's ultimatum, contrary to the federal law language. So those are just a few things that we're dealing with.
And what also about, besides the Supreme Court, what other courts?
Oh, this is really important. People don't realize this. Yeah, the Supreme Court is going to be majorly shifted one way or the other, clearly. And all these cases are going to the Supreme Court, deals with religious freedom and all these issues, like never before. But the whoever's in the White House also appoints federal district judges and federal circuit court judges. Now, three-fourths of our circuit courts, that's under the Supreme Court, three-fourths of them, we're in the Ninth Circuit, three-fourths of the circuits are already dominated by judicial activists. Only a fourth are not. And I will tell you something, Craig. In the next 4 years, depending on who's in the White House, I can see virtually all of those circuits being taken over, all of them controlled by judicial activists, which would be a huge hindrance upon those of us who are fighting for your freedom and religious freedom and things like this and the sanctity of human life. So this is a high-stakes election. Let me just give a quick analogy. I look at this as like you have two people applying for a janitor job, okay? And you're not really sure which you like, which one you want for the janitor job. Oh, but by the way, the janitor is going to be the one appointing the new CEO of the company. That's how I see it. Thank you. God bless you all very much. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Brad. So now, you can see how important the Supreme Court is, and you see why Christians are very concerned we're going to lose our First Amendment rights. We're going to talk about where Trump and Hillary stand on some key issues. One is right to worship versus right to religion. Right to worship is we can come into this church and say whatever we want. But right to religion means that if we go outside like that pastor did, we can't say whatever we believe. It's a big cultural shift. And that's why it's so important. Now, what I'm going to do is send to you a list of some of the major cases that Brad was talking about with the Pacific Justice Institute. Also a video of the slate mailings and some other videos I'll tell you about in a second. So if you'd like to get that in an update, I'm going to pass this around. And so sign that. Even if you sign the petition, sign that, because this is going to send you the updates. So let's go to the next. So right to worship. Hillary believes, yeah, you can worship however you want in a church, but not outside. That's why a lot of Christian groups under Obama, did you know this? That if you're like a Christian organization and you get some type of federal food or federal money to distribute, you cannot pass out a tract, you cannot pray, you cannot tell them about Jesus. That's illegal. And that's only been under Obama. That's right to worship. That's what Hillary Clinton believes, Donald Trump, right to religion, meaning you have a First Amendment right to spread the gospel. Protection of Christian business owners, Clinton, no. Donald Trump, yes. Protection of Christian government employees, Clinton, no. Donald Trump, yes. Biblical prayer and witnessing in the military. Do you know, Brad, I'm right on this, right, that if I'm in the military and I have the Bible on my desk, I could be court-martialed, right?
Yeah, with the new rules in the last 7 years, this is really important. There's an audience mic. Is this the audience mic right here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, real quick, I'll just sit up here. But, yeah, actually, before, there was no problem. In fact, faith was embedded with your chaplain program and everything else. Things have radically changed. And you talk to chaplains, they'll tell you. And now, that's right. There is a purging. There's already been a purging at the high level with regards to
even
generals.
Among the chaplains as far as leading somebody to Christ.
Oh, majorly. Things have been majorly changed. So the military has had a 180-degree turn, and everyone in the military that I've talked to, whether chaplains or in service, have validated exactly that. So it's very, very serious.
Did you guys know that? So
yeah.
Biblical prayer and witnessing in the military, Clinton, no. Donald Trump, yes. Fairness doctrine. How many know what the fairness doctrine is? Okay, a number of you do, but most do not. Give me the name of a Bible teacher you listen to on the radio. David Jeremiah? So let's say David Jeremiah takes Psalm 139 and talks about the right to life, about life beginning at conception. He does that on his radio program. He paid for that radio program. Under the fairness doctrine, he has to give free time to Planned Parenthood to give a pro-abortion message. Now, that's the way the law was back before Ronald Reagan got rid of it in 1984, and that opened up talk radio and all kinds of diverse opinions. But she, Hillary Clinton, wants to put back fairness doctrine. Donald Trump says no, he's against it. One of the biggest battles, Brad, am I right? In the next 3 to 4 years, one of the biggest battles will be the tax exemption of churches.
Yeah, yes, you are exactly right on that. It's not going to be 20 or 30 years. We're expecting the next few years. Church tax exemption is going to be on the chopping block. It's one of the most imminent risks and direct attacks on religious freedom.
Yeah, and you're going to see it. Now, this could be ministries, but it could also be churches, thousands. Thousands of little churches are going to go out of business. And so Clinton, we don't know. Trump says he wants to keep the tax exemption for churches. What Brad was talking about, Christian colleges forced to abandon their beliefs. Clinton, yes. Trump, no. Human trafficking. Both of them are pretty good on human trafficking. And then the Johnson Amendment. Now, the Johnson Amendment, how many know what the Johnson Amendment is? Boy, I've never seen a church with so many people who know what the Johnson Amendment is. So I am not giving you my recommendations. I'm giving you the information. Because this is a 501c organization. And it could lose its tax exemption if I came up here and told you how to vote. You see, before 1954, pastors were free to be the conscience of the community and tell people what they thought. And they had the freedom to be able to call out evil and talk about problems. And they were silenced in 1954 by Lyndon Baines Johnson of Texas because he was being attacked by some evangelical churches. So he put into law a church would lose its tax exemption. Now, Brad and I and my wife Shelley, we were back in New York. Hillary Clinton was invited to meet with evangelical leaders. She did not accept. Donald Trump did accept. So Franklin Graham, Greg Laurie, David Jeremiah, a lot of Christian pastors were there. I was at this table with Hank Hanegraaff and some other people. And one-third of the evangelical leaders were for Trump. One-third were against Trump. And one-third just didn't know. And so Donald Trump comes out, and one of the first things he says is that one of the first things he'll do as president is he will get rid of the Johnson Amendment. We almost fell off our chairs. He got a standing ovation. Nobody could believe he said that because no presidential candidate in the history of the United States has ever said they wanted to get rid of the Johnson Amendment. And so that would restore pastors' First Amendment rights. Yes. So what about life? You know, with life, I get my guidance from the Word of God. And throughout the Word of God, I hear about life beginning at conception. Psalm 139. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them were I to count them. They would outnumber the grains of sand. God's thoughts to you, precious. You know how much God loves you? And while you were in your mother's womb, you know, the scientists this year saw at the moment of conception this explosion of light. And they recorded it. In Genesis, it talks about in the beginning was what? Light. Life begins with this burst of light. I'm going to send you a video of that if you sign in that sheet. It's absolutely amazing. Post it on Facebook. Send it out to your friends. But here's the thing. Most people, at least half the people in any church, they've had abortion or they know somebody who's had an abortion. And God's a God of forgiveness, a God of love, a God of second chances. But I believe as a church, we need to be promoting a culture of life. And adoption. You know, in the 50s is when I was born. And with the abortion laws then, my mom could not abort me. So I was adopted. And I praise God for the parents I had. And to me, this is very personal. But it's based upon throughout Scripture, life begins at conception, and so we need to protect the unborn because otherwise it's murder. Now, next. Obamacare should pay for abortion. Hillary Clinton says yes. Taxes should pay for abortion. Donald Trump, no. Life begins at conception. Hillary Clinton, no. Donald Trump, yes. Taxpayers' dollars for Planned Parenthood. Hillary Clinton says yes. Donald Trump has a kind of a weird thing. Yes. Federal tax money for Planned Parenthood, but only if they don't do abortion. In other words, no money if they do abortion. Next. And what about partial birth abortion? Now, in the last debate, Hillary Clinton was in there talking about how she supported second and third trimester of killing of a baby. If a baby is born alive and you kill the baby, that's called what?
Murder.
Murder, but it's infanticide. So what partial birth abortion is, you take this viable baby and you put it out of the womb, but not all the way out, just enough so that you can suck the brain out and kill the baby. That's partial birth. That's why, you know, Brad and I were talking about the Supreme Court doing some good things and some bad things because it's kind of divided. One of the good things is they said partial birth abortion could finally be hindered on the state level, and some states have done that. Clinton is for partial birth abortion. Donald Trump is not. Next. And what about Israel? Support for Israel. Both are supporting Israel, but under Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, the attacks on Israel have been historic. We've never seen anything like it. And then move American embassy to Jerusalem. You know, every embassy is in the capital, except in Israel. We're in Tel Aviv. But see, Hillary's kind of like, I want to divide Jerusalem into two, Muslim and the Jewish state, the Palestinian and the Jewish state. So Clinton is against moving the embassy. Donald Trump is for it. And what about Netanyahu coming to Congress for his historic speech? Clinton's against it. Trump is for it. Next. And what about Obamacare? It's falling apart, guys. Our health system, private doctors are disappearing. Giant corporations are consolidating. Premiums are spiking. Deductibles are going up. You're going to have the longest lines. You're going to have shortages. It's going to be a nightmare. And it's becoming something that the only solution is either to get rid of Obamacare or have a completely government-run system, a socialistic system, like the failed ones of Europe. So Clinton is for continuing with Obamacare. Trump says he wants to repeal it and replace it with free market alternatives. The schools are a mess with Common Core, with a dumbed-down education, with unions strangling education, and the poor and the minority kids are the ones hurt the most. Now, what we have is a school monopoly. A government school monopoly. What Clinton wants to do is continue it. Trump wants to blow it up by allowing parents to send their kids to private schools, to Christian schools, to charter schools. He wants to try to blow it up. Allow Muslim refugees into the U.S. Now, this is what Dana was talking about. They're not being vetted. Hillary wants to increase it dramatically, and Trump wants to stop it. Next. More gun control. Hillary, yes. In fact, what she wants to do, if some crazy guy comes up and shoots somebody, she wants to sue the gun manufacturer to put them out of business. And we have Donald Trump, no on more gun control. Criminal justice reform, we don't know about Donald. Clinton wants it. We do need it. Balanced budget plan, Hillary Clinton, no. Donald Trump, yes. Next. Increased taxes on small business owners and the wealthy, Clinton, yes. Donald Trump, just on hedge fund managers. He wants to reduce taxes. Increased regulations. When I was on Neil Cavuto the last time, he asked me, Craig, what is the number one thing that's killing the business growth and economic recovery? And I said regulations. Most economists agree it's the excessive regulations that's killing business. Now, Clinton wants to continue with the executive orders and the excessive job-killing regulations. Trump wants to get rid of them. Lower capital gains taxes. This is where we have the highest capital gains tax in the world. And so companies, trillions of dollars have gone overseas. Clinton wants to keep it at the high rate. Trump wants to lower it to try to get them to come back to the U.S. Next. A minimum wage. Clinton wants $15, $12 to $15 an hour. Donald Trump says no. College tuition. She wants free. Donald Trump talks about interest rate reduction. Job creation. In the last debate, she talked about having more stimulus programs like we had under Obama. And Trump says, no, those did not work. What I want to do is get rid of Obamacare that's killing jobs, get rid of the taxes that's killing jobs, and get rid of regulations that's killing jobs. Immigration, build a wall, Clinton, no. Donald Trump, yes. Immigration, amnesty, Clinton, yes. Donald Trump, no. Next. Now, we put a rating on these candidates, and so I'm going to give you the ratings. Next. So Clinton has a conservative Christian worldview of about 11%. Donald Trump has a conservative Christian worldview of about 72%. So the opposite. What about Clinton's liberal secular worldview, 89 versus Trump's 28? How about more government programs? Clinton 86, Trump 35. Next. Now, Senate. We'll start going down the ballot and into the propositions. You don't have much of a choice with the Senate. They're both candidates that agree on almost every single issue. They're progressive left. But let me give you some ideas. Kamala Harris, she's the attorney general. She's the one that has been going out with gun legislation that has been turned down by the court. She has demanded conservatives turn over their fundraising list, but the court turned that down. And remember that filmmaker that was doing the Planned Parenthood investigation undercover, the selling body parts? She raided his home with armed people. And you know what happened? All of his stuff was taken. Hundreds of thousands of dollars of legal fees. You know what the judge said? She was wrong. He had the right to do the underground video. But that's after all this persecution. She will be the next president of the United States in about 8 years on the trajectory she has. That's what's expected. Or, Brad, she may be appointed to the Supreme Court. So she's a rising star, progressive liberal. She's running against Loretta Sanchez, also a liberal Democrat. Again, not much difference. She's been in Congress now 30 years, 25 years. Harris has 4% conservative Christian worldview, Sanchez a 9%. Harris has more government programs than 93, Sanchez 86. Not much different. Next. The Democratic Party, Obama, all of them were supporting Kamala Harris. She has 39% polling, $7.8 million. Loretta Sanchez has a scattering of Democratic support. 24%, 2.6 million. They both have a California Pro-Life Council rating of zero. The radical NARL, NARL, is a pro-abortion group. They both have 100%, and they both get an F by the National Rifle Association. That's how it is with all the ratings. Hugh Hewitt, the conservative radio commentator, and Congressman Daryl Issa, the moderate conservative congressman from San Diego, they both are supporting Sanchez to try to stop Kamala Harris. Next. Dana Rohrabacher, who you heard from, is running against Suzanne Savory. That is wrong. Dana is a Republican. I'm glad he left. He would give me a hard time on that one. Oh, my. Dana has a Christian conservative worldview of 99, Savory of 5. More government, Dana would have more government program of 5, Savory of 91. So they're just the opposite on almost every issue. And on my website, I give more information about these local races than we have time for. Next. On the assembly, we got Travis Allen, the Republican, that is right, he's the incumbent, versus Lenore Albert Sheridan, the Democrat. Albert Sheridan has a Christian conservative worldview of 9. Allen has one of 82. On more government programs, Albert Sheridan, 84. Allen has 18. And I will say this about Allen. He helped defeat the bill that would have been the death of Christian education. He helps try to stop the bill that was passed into law that said that the counseling centers had to promote Planned Parenthood and abortion. So he's had some really good votes. Next. County Board of Supervisor, District 1. We have a Republican, Andrew Due, versus Michelle Martinez, the Democrat. Due has a Christian conservative worldview of 84, Martinez of 13. Due has more government programs of 26, Martinez of 79. Next. Now let's go down the 17 confusing propositions. We're going to go through them really quick. The first thing, though, there's two that are bonds. Bonds are the most expensive way to finance any type of program. You only do a bond if it helps everybody in the state, has payback that makes sense. And there's no other way to finance it because bonds are not free money. For every dollar you spend, you have to pay back $2. Who gets that extra dollar? It's bankers and investors. And it comes out of the general fund. Instead of better roads, instead of water projects, you're paying bankers. So you don't want to do a bond. Next. So the first one is a bond. And this was put on the ballot by the construction industry, the builders and the architects. And they wanted to have a bond to rebuild a number of schools. Now, here's the problem with it. Those who are opposed to this say, hey, wait, this isn't right. Those in Fountain Valley could be building a school over in Newport Beach, and they get no value from it. Those against it say, hey, there's a problem because this money is unaccountable. We don't know how much those buildings are going to cost and where they're going to go, and it's not accountable. And those for it say, hey, our schools are in disrepair and we need to upgrade some of these schools. Now, those for it are the Democratic Party and school districts throughout California. Those against it are the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, the Conservative California Republican Assembly, the California Republican Women's Federation, and guess what? Jerry Brown is against it. And the CTA and the Democrats are so mad at him, and you know why? Because it's a bond. And California has more bond debt than any other state. It will destroy our state rating, hike up interest rates. And he says we have this wall of debt, and he's against it. Amen. Next. Now, Proposition 52. Two-thirds legislative vote required to amend fees to hospitals. So, under Obamacare, a hospital had to have a fee or be taxed. But here's the thing. They would get more money than that fee or tax. So they're getting this huge cash flow of money coming in from Obamacare. And so what this does, this locks it in and says there'll have to be a two-thirds vote to get rid of it. Well, you never get two-thirds vote to get rid of something. Those for it say, hey, let's just keep it going to the hospitals because the hospitals are making money on it. Those against it say, yeah, at the expense of the patient, but also Obamacare may go away or may be changed. And this will be locked in, and there's nothing we can do about it. So those for this are the California Hospital Association, the Democratic Party, and the hospitals paid the Republican Party a lot of money, and the Republican Party's for it too. Those against it are liberal and conservative. Some unions are against it, but so is the Conservative California Republican Assembly and the Christian Capital Resource Institute. Next. And then revenue bonds. This is another bond. For every dollar spent, you got to pay $2. Now, the Democratic legislature and Jerry Brown have been using these revenue bonds to spend a lot of money. And we never vote on it. The legislature votes on it. And so this bullet train to nowhere is a revenue bond. The tunnels he wants to build, revenue bonds. So those for it say, yeah, the legislature should make bonds. Those against it say, no, bonds are too expensive. Only the voters should vote for bonds and not the legislature. So for this, saying vote yes on this is the California Republican Party, the California Republican Assembly, the Federation of Republican Women, and the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. They say you should vote on this, not let the legislature. Those against it, are the Democratic Party and the Building and Construction Trades Council. Next. Now, California is the most corrupt state for the legislature in the United States. More assemblymen and state senators are in jail than any other state in the nation, or going to be in jail, too. And see, here's the thing. What happens is they have this really corrupt thing called gut and amend. So if you have a bill that goes to Sacramento, it goes through the legislature, and the media see it, and the people for it see it, and the people against see it, and it's debated in several committees, and finally it's voted upon. But with gut and amend, they take out all that stuff that was debated and put in a brand new bill with the other number and vote on it without anybody knowing what's in it except the legislators. It's corrupt, happens 5 or 6 times a year. So this was put on the ballot to stop the gut and amend. This says that any bill that's voted on has to have 72 hours of being publicized, and that the best that sunlight is the best disinfectant to use. Now, those against it say, well, there's emergencies and you got to do that, and the Democratic legislature is able to pass a lot of good bills. So those for it are the California Republican Party, California Federation of Republican Women, and the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. Those against it are the Labor, the Democratic Party, and the Democratic legislators. Next. Proposition 30. Back in 2012, the budget deficit was in a crisis. Remember those days? And the schools were being hammered and hit. And a lot of layoffs and cutting down. And so what Governor Brown did, he pushed a tax on people earning $200,000 a year to the highest income tax in the nation, 13.5%. But the thing is, not only does it hit people with $200,000 or more a year, that includes small business owners who they may show on their taxes $200,000 a year, and they're not making $200,000 a year. So we have 5.5 businesses every week leaving California. We have a crisis because this is the most anti-business friendly state in the nation, and one of it is this tax. So if you vote for this, you keep the tax, and you keep the money going to the schools. Now those against it say California has a record revenue. School spending's up several 100% despite this. We have enough money to be able to pay for the schools without having this excess tax. So those for this who say keep the tax are the teachers' union and the Democratic Party. Those against it are the California Republican Party, the Chamber of Commerce, Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, National Federation of Independent Business, all say vote no. Next. Then tobacco. So right now, people who smoke tobacco pay 80 cents per pack. This puts it up to $2 a pack, and it includes electronic cigarettes. Those for it say the government should try to stop people from smoking. Those against it say that's not the proper role of government to be a nanny state. Plus, whenever you do a tax like this that's so high, there's an unintended consequence. What is that? Black market. So what will happen with $2, all these people will figure out how to sell cigarettes outside of the tax system. So two things will happen. Law enforcement will be diverted to chasing after people selling cigarettes, like they do in New York. And the second thing that will happen is that there'll be this new crime element in wealthy people because they've learned how to do it the black market. So those for this are the Democratic Party and the California School Board Association. Those against it, the California Republican Party, the Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, the Christian Capital Resource Institute, and the Conservative California Republican Assembly. And you see a lot of money for this because guess who's trying to stop it? The cigarette industry. Next. Now, this is misnamed. Camilla Harris names all the propositions. And this one says juvenile. That's part of it. But basically what this is the early release of prisoners that Governor Brown has been trying to do. This is his bill to get rid of a lot of the prisoners now in prison. Now, we have been doing this for quite a while, and there's a spike in crime of 10% in California, and it keeps rising. Those for this say, rightly, too many people are in jail that should not be in jail, and they become hardened criminals when they come out. Too many people have been arrested for minor offenses and gotten felonies, and it's ruined their lives. They're right. But those against us say that this doesn't correct the right. This lets out a lot of people. They say it's poorly written. It releases the wrong people, including rapists and human trafficking. And that it's going to, and one of the things they say, it's a constitutional amendment. So if it's poorly written, you can't change it. So they're against it. So those for it are Jerry Brown and Gavin Newsom and the Democratic Party. Those against it are California Republican Assembly, California Republican Party, and most California district attorneys. Next. Multilingual education. Who was here in 1998? Remember the big battle for English immersion, English only in the schools? See, what was happening is kids were being taught Spanish in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade, and they weren't, that English was not, was like a second language. Well, mainly Hispanic parents were so upset because they wanted their kids to learn English. So the voters passed English immersion. And the most test scores and most teachers said that was great because the kids accelerated, they assimilated in society, and it was better for California. But some people didn't like it, and some tests show there were some problems. And while a parent could opt out and say, I want my kid only to learn Chinese, they could do that under the current law. A lot of people want to get rid of English only. So that's what this is. So if you vote for this, you're getting rid of English only. If you vote no on this, you're saying keep it the way it is where there's English immersion. Those saying get rid of English immersion are the California Democratic Party, CTA, and the SEIU. Those against it, California Republican Assembly, California Republican Party, California Federation of Republican Women. Overturn Citizens United. I hesitate to even talk about this because what this is, that's a Supreme Court ruling. And whether it passes or not, it doesn't mean a thing. It's just an opinion. Now, what's Citizens United? Basically, it's this. Back in 2008, some businesses donated to a group, Citizens United, to create a film against Hillary Clinton. And the government stopped that film from being shown because it was businesses putting money into it. So the Supreme Court said those businesses have a First Amendment right to be involved in the political process, and it was legal to do it. Now, since then, quite frankly, the people who have benefited the most are all these businesses like Wells Fargo and these companies have poured more money into liberal groups than businesses have put into conservative groups. So, but the liberal left hates Citizens United, even though they benefit more from it. So those for it are the Democratic Party and San Francisco Chronicle. But what's interesting, because it's such a nonsense thing, the conservative Christian Republican Assembly says vote no, but so does the liberal LA Times and the moderate San Diego Union, because they say don't bother people's time and effort with such a silly thing. Okay, next. Then we have Condoms for Pornographic Films Initiative. So in LA County, they already have this. But basically what this does, your tax money will go to set up a new bureaucracy in Sacramento with bureaucrats that go and watch porno films being made to make sure that the male porno stars are wearing condoms. And those for it say that's to protect the porno stars. Those against it say this is the nanny state gone crazy. Taxpayers shouldn't have to put up with it and have to pay for that. Those for it are the AIDS Healthcare Foundation and occupational health nurses. Those against it are the Democratic Party, the Republican Party, the California Republican Assembly, and the California Libertarian Party. Next. Then we have this one is the price fixing. So here's the thing. All of you have gotten direct mail, and you're going to get a lot more direct mail about this. This is the one where you see lots of TV and radio commercials, and the vets have gone ballistic on this. So let me explain this real quickly. Why is the American Legion and the Americans' foreign wars, why are they so against this? Everybody agrees that medication and pharmaceuticals is priced too high. But there's two philosophies of what to do. One is they're priced high because the government has been meddling in the free market. You see, the FDA, and partially because of lawsuits, but the FDA in particular has created some monopolies and high cost to entry and way too expensive for companies to be able to create pharmaceuticals. And then when they create them, they get this monopoly. So the answer is to have the free market solve this problem by getting the FDA out of the way. The other side says, well, the government needs to get involved, and the government needs to fix it, so we got to have price fixing. Well, the problem with price fixing, this is a government intervention that has always created shortages and all kinds of unintended consequences. So those who are against this say there's going to be shortages, and here's why the vets are so upset. Because of an oddity in the way the law is with the national deals that they have with the pharmaceuticals, they're afraid that the pharmaceuticals are going to raise the prices for everyone across the United States, including California, so that the prices for medication will even be higher. That's the unintended consequence. And so government intervention versus the free market is where this stands. So those for this are the California Democratic Party, Bernie Sanders, you've probably seen Bernie Sanders, the socialist TV commercials, and Al Sharpton. Those against it are the California Republican Party, the conservative California Republican Assembly, and guess what? The pharmaceutical companies who have been putting in the money. It says 9 million. Now it's up to about 35 million for. Contributions are closer to 90 million against. Next. Then the death penalty. Keep this simple. If you believe that the death penalty is immoral and should be abolished, vote yes. If you believe that the death penalty is something that the government has the right to do if somebody takes a life and could be a deterrent against a certain number of people, then you should vote no on this. It has nothing to do with the fact that the death penalty is broken in California. That's the next initiative I'll talk about on the death penalty. This one is just whether we should have it or not. Should California have the death penalty? Yes, California if the California should abolish the death penalty, you vote yes. If you want to keep the death penalty because you believe it's a deterrent, you vote no. California Democratic Party says yes. Bernie Sanders says yes. District attorneys and sheriffs throughout California say no. Conservative California Republican Assembly says no. Next. Safety for all. Gavin Newsom wants to run for governor in 2 years. This is his bill to get publicity. Because of a unique Supreme Court ruling that protects Second Amendment rights, he decided, let's control ammunition. So this is massive regulation of ammunition. So if you believe in more gun control, you should vote yes. If you believe gun control should not have more in the ammunition, you should vote no. Okay? So for this are Feinstein and Boxer and Newsom. Those against it are the California Republican Assembly, California Sheriff's Association, and the National Rifle Association. Next. Marijuana. Now, this is not whether or not you want to smoke marijuana or not. This is whether or not it should be legal or not. So let me explain it this way. Many states are now legalizing marijuana. There's controversy if it's working, if it's not working, but it's by state by state. So we'll see if some states it works and some states it doesn't. Those who are for it say people should be able to smoke it as long as they don't harm anybody else, and that the war on drugs has been a failure. And it's created these giant murderous cartels, billion-dollar cartels, because it's a black market. Those against it say, hey, we don't know yet what's happening in the other states. It could hurt the kids, and it could create more crime. And so the Democratic Party says vote yes. Now, interesting, Congressman Rohrabacher says yes, too. And he's a conservative. But so does Tom McClintock. And so does Glenn Beck. And it's kind of a tradition of William F. Buckley and Barry Goldwater all were for the legalization of marijuana because they didn't believe government should be involved in that because of the creating the black market and the cartels. And the California Medical Association. Now, on the other side, California Republican Party says no. The California Association of Highway Patrolmen say no. And here's something that's interesting. The Libertarian Party that believes in the legalization of marijuana because they believe you should be have the freedom to do what you want as long as you don't harm anyone else, they're against it. They say vote no because they say the regulations and taxes are so complicated, it's going to hurt the medical marijuana industry. And what it'll do, it'll create giant corporations getting into selling marijuana instead of small entrepreneurs. So it's a controversy. You got conservatives and liberals on both sides. You got libertarians saying no. And so far, 60% of the people say yes, 36% say no, 4% undecided. Next. Dedication of revenue for disposable bags. Now, do you have to pay 10 cents a bag here in Orange County? You guys are so lucky. In Huntington Beach. See, I have to pay 10 cents. Every single bag. And you know who gets that 10 cents? Well, here's the thing. The bag industry thought they'd make a deal with the legislature. They made a deal with the legislature, and the legislature stabbed them in the back. So they put two things on the ballot. One is this. The retailers keep that 10 cents people like me have to pay. What they're saying, hey, we'll make the liberal Democrats happy with us because we'll take that money and we'll give it to environmental groups. Well, those for it say, well, yeah, because retailers shouldn't keep the money. Those against it say, wait a minute, these environmental groups are probably political groups and you're giving all this millions of dollars to political activist liberal groups that call themselves environmental groups. Those for the bag industry, those against it are the California, those who say vote no are the California Republican Party, even the League of Women Voters, the Libertarian Party, and the Christian Capital Resource Institute. Next. 66, this is the other death penalty. This one's kind of just the opposite, okay? This, you're voting yes if you believe in the death penalty. But this bill, what this does, it says the death penalty is a deterrent. It's a good thing to have because it could save lives. But the death penalty is broken because these guys are on death row hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, and they keep appealing, and they stay on until they die, and they never get executed. So this stops the constant appealing and misusing of the system. So this tries to restrict that so that the death penalty will actually work. So if you vote yes, if you like the death penalty, this is for the death penalty and to fix it, you vote yes. If you think the death penalty is wrong and immoral, you vote no. California Republican Party is for it. California Republican Assembly is for it. And California District Attorneys and Law Enforcement are for it. Those against it, teachers union, labor unions. Next. The final one is 67. This is also plastic bags. Now, what this is, if you want to keep the ban on plastic bags, you vote yes. If you want to get rid of the ban on plastic bags, and for me, the extra 10 cents, you vote no. Does that make sense? Okay, so if you want to keep the plastic bag ban, you vote yes. If you want to get rid of the plastic bag ban, you vote no. Those who say keep it are Jerry Brown and the California Democratic Party. Those who say get rid of it, reject the plastic bag, vote no, Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association, California Federation of Republican Women, and the California Republican Assembly. Let's go to the next. Okay, I want to go over seven things with you. And I'll make it really quick, but they're really important. So we got the election coming up. Be sure you get people to the poll. People in your household, people within your church, people within your home Bible studies. Go to electionform.org. You can take your cell phone and go straight down our recommendations if you want to. We've got voter guides you can print out, give out to people. We've got webinars you can listen to where I make recommendations. We got so many resources. Next. So tell people and pray about it. And we need your churches to have salt and light ministries. Next. And then my newsletter, Reality Alert. I want you to be sure to read Reality Alert. I'll send you a copy of it, so look for it in your email if you sign that sheet. If you take Twitter, I send out a lot of great tweets, put a lot of time into them. Be sure to take a look at those. And if you're on Facebook, I really need more friends. Next. And if you are really passionate about politics and stuff, our organization needs a lot of help with research and data entry and phone calls and all kinds of things. Next. And then I just got a few more churches. We're still lining up a few more, but we've got the Bridge out in Palm Springs, Calvary Chapel, Upland. I got Agape Fellowship in Costa Mesa. Probably a few more I forgot. So if you got friends and neighbors in those areas, invite them to come on over. Next. So remember, this is a 501c. Anything said was my opinion. I tried to be as objective, not the pastor, not the elders. Next. So we want education, empowerment, mobilization, and multiplication. That's how we take back America. Next. Amen. So seven solutions. Prayer. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities and powers. This is a spiritual warfare. Don't you agree? This is a spiritual warfare. So you need to pray for President Obama, for Hillary, for Donald, the Supreme Court. You need to pray for this election. You need to be a people of prayer because we're up against it like never before. Two, we need to intelligently vote. When the righteous are in authority, the people do what? And when the wicked are in authority, the people do what? We've got to be able to intelligently vote. Next. We need to seek quality leaders. I believe there would be people here who might want to run for city council or school board or assembly. We need to get people to run and get elected. But at least what you can do is help and be salt and light by helping. Next. And part of that helping is registering and contributing and volunteering and telling others. And with all Fox News and MSNBC and talk radio, we never, ever forget our priority, and that is to know him and to make him known. And we need revival. That's the thing that's going to turn it around. I really believe that politicians can be used by God to help turn this around. But it's a spiritual revival in America that's going to be what turns America around, not politics, not just the vote. That doesn't say we're not involved in that. We have to be involved in that, but it's revival. Next. The first great awakening, I had mentioned before, was in the colonies. And it was absolutely incredible. All over the colonies, what happened was this. There were hilltops with men and women and children. In fact, most revivals have been with millennials. And there was a revival in the colonies. And men and women, they were down on their knees and their hands were lifted to heaven. And they cried out to God for forgiveness, for repentance, for accepting Christ. And all over the colonies, people were accepting Christ. It was amazing. And you know what happened? That was laying the foundation for the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they're endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You know what? Here's the thing. We created a country based upon evangelical, born-again Christians and Christian principles. We created a nation that has sent out more missionaries than any other nation. We have created an economic engine with a free enterprise based upon Christian principles that has lifted people out of poverty like nobody any time in history and nobody would ever expect. A technology, healthcare, education, this was based upon the men and women who laid the foundation of America. But America was turning its back in the early 1800s, just like it's turning its back on God today. And what happened in the early 1800s was people like Garfield that we talked about looked around, and they were part of the second great awakening, the revival. Charles Finney was one of them. And men and women were on hilltops with their hands raised to heaven, crying out to God, asking forgiveness, asking Christ in the heart. It was revival across the United States like you can't believe. And you know what happened? Some of the greatest social transformation in America took place because of the Second Great Awakening at the local level, the state level, and the national level, including the abolition of slavery. You see, when God's people are mobilized through revival and renewal, great things happen. And that's what I'm expecting to happen here in California. God cannot sustain this free and blessed country which we love and pray for unless the church will take right ground. Politics are part of religion in such a country as this, and Christians must do their duty to the country as part of their duty to God. He was one of the great revivalists, and he saw the connection. Next. We have an indifferent church, a church that would much rather have potlucks than it would have prayer meetings and Bible studies and get involved in the political process. But we got to turn that around. You know, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. You know what? I really believe that revival could come from the people right here. I was part of a little revival. It wasn't huge revival, but it's still a historic revival called the Jesus Movement in the 70s. And I was over at Long Beach State, and I lost a bet, and I was invited to this tent. And in this tent, I couldn't believe it. I wore a suit. I thought I was going to go to opera music. And there's a Christian rock band playing, and everybody in flip-flops and T-shirts and shorts. And I couldn't believe the love I felt there. And this man with a big smile is talking about how God loved me. And it multiplied. Can't we have that today? Can't we see it even multiply even bigger than that? I believe it can. And I believe from the people here that go to this church and to other churches, it could multiply out throughout Orange County, throughout the state of California, throughout the nation. Now, I can see that it would be easy to be in despair at all what's going on. But God can turn around just like that. So as we leave tonight, I would like you to join me in prayer. And I like to say a quick prayer, but I'd like you to repeat the prayer after me. And not only that, I would like you all to stand up and hold hands, as uncomfortable as that means, because just as we saw everybody representing the Church of God in the United States, I want you to hold hands now, because we're people who are going to go before the true and living God and ask for a mighty work of God to happen here tonight in our hearts. We're going to ask God to do a mighty work to be able to change our society, that revival would come to Orange County. And we're going to ask that God gives us strength and gives us power to be able to be His ambassadors for Christ, to be part of that change. So let's pray. So just pray after me. Father God, I thank you and praise you for your love. I thank you that you died on the cross. For my sins you rose. You took my sins. You gave me your righteousness. You rose from the dead. And Father, I just thank you that you not only forgave me, but you took my pain, you took my anger, you took my bitterness, and you replaced it with love and joy and peace and hope. Father, I pray that in my heart, in my family, among my friends, in my church, that you would use me as an instrument, as a spokesperson, as a person that helps spark a revival. And we pray for that revival across Orange County. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Hey, God bless you guys. Thanks for your patience. You've been great. Make sure you sign that petition. Sign that sign-in sheet so I can send you the updates and the videos.
Thank you, Craig. Thanks for all the work you're doing. So if you want a DVD of tonight's talk, Dennis is making them right now. So just hang around for a little while.